As Ryan said, we've lived in Fort Worth now actually for about 10 years. His son Miles and I have a love for the Portland Trail Blazers. That's where I grew up. So there's the smile over there. I see where Miles is now. But it's been good. I think I've been to this church now three different times, and I've never actually at least spoken in this room. So it's good to see more people here this evening. When Ryan was asking me, you know, what my job exactly is for EM, what my title is, I said, you know, I like to think of myself as a good news messenger. I think I have the best job in the world. I get to share good news about the good news, capital G, capital N. And you see this picture, even this opening slide, you know, these pictures are made possible by churches like you that are praying, churches like you that are giving, so that we can provide Bibles like the ones these two little girls have, in this case, at a Ukrainian youth camp, who are hungry for the first Bible they've ever perhaps seen, much less owned themselves. And so we are joyfully providing God's Word free of charge in 30 different nations, and now printing in 27 different languages. So if you want to add all of those languages to what Ryan was saying about the various languages that you're serving in, every dollar that you're giving is helping provide Bibles that are going out into 30 different countries, Central and Eastern Europe. And we provide those, like I said, in 27 different languages. We began 60 years ago. This is actually our 60th anniversary as a ministry. And it's given us a good sense of pause and reflection for our staff internally. There's about a dozen of us that work stateside. We have 25 on our European staff. Almost all of them are European-born people. I think two of them are American-born, but have lived there for decades. And so we have all taken time to think about the men and women whose shoulders we stand on, who have taken great risks to get the Bible to others. You see in this picture here, and we'll see a video here in a moment that will share a little bit more about this, but Abilene Christian College, there were about 14 young people, seven married couples in their 20s, and they took the challenge of Otis Gatewood. I don't know if any of you would have ever heard personally Otis Gatewood. I just heard him speak once in my life, but he challenged literally thousands of people. And I know at least hundreds of people responded to his challenge and went to the mission field. These are some of those. They went over in 1961, thought that they would be planting a church in Vienna, Austria, thought that's what God was calling them to do. But within just weeks and then months of being there in Vienna, they started hearing so many stories about people wanting Bibles in communist Russia. And they were hearing stories about ways that Bibles could be smuggled into and behind the wall of communism. And so they began to print Bibles covertly. They would have little bitty Bibles that they affectionately called the Marlboro Bible, because it was about the size of a pack of cigarettes. And when you were going across a checkpoint, if you had one of these little Bibles in a pocket somewhere and you were frisked and patted down, they might think it was just a pack of cigarettes. So that was the most popular Bible that was printed, a Russian New Testament in those years. And to hear the stories that they have told now over six decades is amazing, to hear the risks that they have taken. We, in the process of this 60th anniversary, interviewed one of the widows now who was on that original team. And she said, you know, I'm not sure that I've ever shared this story with you before. And sure enough, none of us had heard it. They used to have a VW camper bus, if you remember those. Maybe they still make them, I don't know. But they would have a mattress in the back so it could be a sleeper. Well, they would put their kids on some of their trips into communist Russia. They would make sure that the kids were asleep on that mattress. And underneath that mattress, that's where they put all of the Bibles that they were smuggling in. When she told that story, although it's my ninth year working for EM, and I believe that the Bible should be freely accessible for everyone in the world, something disturbed me about hearing that story. And I guess it was the dad in me with three daughters that I have. And it's like, wow, those people were committed to getting the Bible as a priority, even over the safety of themselves and their sleeping children in the back of their VW camper. So to hear some of those stories and to just make some realities out of all of those times when they successfully smuggled literally thousands, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of Bibles during those years from 61 till communism came down and that wall came down about 1989. And then by 91 or so, most of these countries had become independent. But we celebrate the efforts of many different people, not just the original 14 missionaries that went over to Austria thinking that they were just there to plant one church. You can see on the slide, on the screen now, perhaps, yeah, that's a pretty big screen. Maybe you can read those better than at some churches where I show this slide. These are the countries, a sum of the languages that we print in. I used this slide last year. It's up to now. By the end of last year, 25. And now this year, we started printing in two additional languages. So 27 different languages. And we have a host of different partners in Europe. You know, if you were a missionary in Latvia, and you heard about EEM, that we print Latvian children's Bibles, adult Bibles, that we have perhaps a Christian book on parenting that we have translated into Latvian, you might be very excited to hear that those were available to you upon request, free of charge. So we have lots of missionaries. We have, you know, the Sunset School of Preaching that is in Ukraine. Other places like that that are helping prepare church planters and preachers in those areas. But you look down just this list of a sample of just some of the many sort of boots on the ground partners that we have. There's a lot of unexpected groups too. Would you think that prisons, libraries, public schools would be asking us for Bibles? If someone came to your leaders here at this church and said, you know, the whole school district here that covers all of Olathe and the surrounding cities, we're going to offer Christian ethics as an elective in all of our public schools. Some of you, I can see you're rolling your eyes like that would never happen. It's how we feel about a lot of the direction of our country. But if that were to happen, I think the answer would not be yes or no, but it would be, how many do you need? Yes, we will provide them. So we've had Russia first, and then it was Ukraine. Ukraine continues to ask us for Bibles in their schools. Over 75% of the public schools now have God's Word as the textbook for Christian ethics. And they see their test rates going up wherever they have Bibles. Interesting. Other nations around Ukraine are noticing the difference in their education system. Ukraine has not been a model of education in past decades, but they have been now for almost 15 years that they've been asking for Bibles. So Hungary, Romania, Serbia, Croatia, now Northern Macedonia, there's a host of other countries paying attention to the difference that the Bible is making in the lives of kids. For us, that's not surprising, but for them, they're coming still out of this communist era, and even though they're 30 years or so out of it, they would say, oh, the residue of communism is still here. We don't trust each other. We don't even trust our own family members, much less our leaders and our policemen. And we certainly don't trust foreigners, and you Americans used to be our enemies. I mean, there's a vast void of trust. And yet, after being there now as EEM for 60 years, praise the Lord, He has built up trust with many different groups. And they want to work with us exclusively because of that trust. So we're grateful that over all of these decades, God has built relationships that has resulted in more and more people receiving His Word. For the accountants or the statisticians in the crowd, I guess you might get excited about this next stat or this next slide. But these are the last few years of just the total number of Bibles and books that we've been able to distribute. And if you look at last year, it was our best year ever. Who would predict that COVID could somehow be simultaneously with the word best year ever? But in our case, I know it's not been true of all nonprofits, but in our case, we had more people in their generosity give to provide Bibles, and at the same time, we had even more people than ever before asking for Bibles. And that, I don't think, is a coincidence. People were looking for answers. You hear about people when they've gone through a divorce, or the loss of a job, or the death of a family member, or maybe it's even as something as simple and yet as stressful as moving across the country for a new job. Those are all points at which, generally speaking, people are more open to a different answer to the questions of life, maybe changing what they believe. Well, I think that's happened in a vast way around the globe, given a lot of the challenges that this pandemic has brought. The most staggering statistic to me, though, is this one that shows 1.7 million people actually asked us last year for a Bible. So we had to turn down over 350,000 people who were asking. We did so lovingly. We didn't say, no, you can't. We said, yes, you can, but not yet. And so it's kind of felt like a punch in the gut to us to give more Bibles than ever. We're celebrating that. But to have even more people than we can say yes to, it's been painful to say that. Can you imagine if someone walked in right now and said, I'm not here to listen to the speaker or to worship with you, but could I get a Bible? You'd hate the thought that one of the leaders of this church would have to say, well, why don't you check back in 6 months? We might have, a line item in the budget for that. We wouldn't. We'd hand them one of ours. We'd show them how to get the app. We'd say, can we take you to a store to help you find a Bible that you will really want to read? But in our case, more Bibles distributed last year than ever, and yet more people than that asking for them. So we praise God for so many opportunities. In this box that you see on the slide here is the nation of Bulgaria. And I'm just singling them out because this incredible picture was taken just about a year and a half ago. Our one worker, Demetrius Argyropoulos, who lives in Athens, Greece, he works in several different nations. Bulgaria is fairly close to Greece. He was asked to come and speak at a church in Bulgaria. And as he got there and got up to speak that morning, he said, would everybody open up their Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 13? We're going to talk about the amazing love of God. Everyone stood up in the room. He said, I counted 43 adults and they all stood. I had no idea why. I thought, oh, maybe they're standing for the reading of God's word in honor of the word of God. Well, no, not exactly. They all ended up standing and walking down to the one woman who owned a Bible. They all wanted to see 1 Corinthians 13 on the one Bible that the 43 of them together owned. Demetrius couldn't believe it. He said, I wish I had known. I would have brought Bulgarian language Bibles with me. We have some in Athens. And so this was actually the day that they had shipped some New Testaments, and one of the leaders at that church was handing them out to the young people. But can you believe a church of committed followers of Jesus, and only one of them had a Bible? I don't know the backstory. How did they all become Christians? I don't know. But they all have Bibles now, and yet they represent a host of people, literally more than 1 million each year, that are asking us for a Bible because they don't own one. There was a Romanian minister during the communist era. His name was Richard Wurmbrand. I don't know if any of you have read his book, Tortured for Christ. I see one person nodding their head. You may have heard of the ministry Voice of the Martyrs. Not a Church of Christ ministry coming out of our churches, but amazing stories raising awareness of people who are being killed or persecuted, imprisoned because of their faith around the world. I read that story last year. He spent 14 years in prison, nearly died almost every single one of those 14 years. And it was all because he was simply sharing the good news, like I am tonight, like Ryan did from this same pulpit, like we all did in the songs that we were singing of truth and of good news. I don't know which face in this picture jumps out the most at you, but if you take a look at it, is there one that grabs you? This picture for me represents just last year, 1.7 million people reaching out specifically just to us in just this one part of the world, Eastern and Central Europe, reaching out for God's word. All of the people in this picture got a copy of God's word. But some are having to wait. I'm not sure which face grabs you the most, but as I've looked at that picture, it wasn't the first one that grabbed me, but there's a couple of boys in this picture that, to me, kind of, I'm imagining their intentions, and I don't know. But it's almost like I'm willing to throw some elbows if I have to get my Bible. Which makes me think about that time when Jesus was on his way to heal that man's daughter. Remember, Jairus had asked him, and so there's this big crowd, you know the story, there's a woman who had been sick for years, bleeding, couldn't stop, spent all her money, and then some. She thought, if I could just touch Jesus, I bet I could be healed. Jesus says, who touched me? And my paraphrase, the apostles are like, who didn't touch you? Who's not touching you? Everybody's touching you. No, I felt power go out. That woman realized she was going to have to fess up to being the one that he was talking about. And he says, your faith has healed you. I think about just this picture and all of the literal millions of people around the globe who don't yet have God's word. Many of them are reaching for it, both literally and spiritually, wanting it, ready for it. You all as a church have given, I didn't even tell Ryan this before tonight at least, but all total, a little over $17,000. You divide that by our average cost to print and publish and distribute one book, each Bible, each book, about $5 is our average cost. So that's a lot of Bibles. I'm not a mathematician, but that's well over 3,000 if... So you've given the seed of the good news to thousands of people already, just through this ministry in that part of the world. Who knows what all you're doing locally here, what you're doing in other places, in other languages as well. But God sees those seeds that are being planted, and others are coming and watering those. As Paul says, I planted, Apollos watered, but God is the one who makes it grow. So I hope that as you hear tonight some of what you have given to, at least as a church corporately, what I hope you will add your prayers to, or add even more prayer to, for this particular ministry. I hope that you'll pray for the 1.33 million people who have just in the last 12 months received what for most of them is the first Bible they've ever owned. And then for that other 370,000 just last year that asked but couldn't get one last year, and that we have thankfully caught up with. Well, as of September 1st this year, if you compare that with our distribution of Bibles last year by September 1st, we are 58% ahead of last year. 58%. I don't know if any of you are business owners, but I mean, if you have a year where you're 5% ahead of last year or 8% ahead, I mean, that is a good year. If I'm your employee, I'm hoping for a bonus that year. Or maybe we should invest in your company if it's a stock. But this is eternal lives, and we're 58%. God has put us in a position where more people, even than last year, are already receiving his word. And the end of 2021 is an unfinished story. But we're looking forward to seeing how God will finish this year and how he will lead us into the next year, Lord willing, and until Jesus returns. The next couple of slides are just a few pictures from a delivery that we had in the nation of Croatia last year when I was here with a smaller group in a different part of your building, I think over there somewhere. I shared about how Croatia last year shocked us. They asked for 492,000 Bibles. Right at the end of 2019, they said, next year, in 2020, could we get basically 500,000 Bibles? We wish that we could have said yes to that, but a lot of that 370,000 that we couldn't fully say yes to until this year were Croatian children's Bibles. And so these slides are just showing some of the 7 semi-truck trailers full of 300 pallets of children's Bibles for Croatian kids. Amazing to think about the future of Croatia and the children being given these Bibles. What used to be sneaking a few Bibles, hiding them behind hubcaps, sneaking them into some luggage, and declaring that a huge victory, given the political circumstances of that time. Now it's overt trucks full and dispersing them freely and openly. And we just praise God for so many people. We have what we call Million Dollar Sunday. It begins September 1st each year, runs through the end of the year. And you all sometimes have given to that. Other times you've given earlier in the year. You actually gave early this year your largest gift. I think it was $9,000 is what you gave earlier this year out of your missions contribution, I believe. But this year, as we're finishing the year, we're especially focused on Million Dollar Sunday. And I have a video here that will explain a bit more of our 60th anniversary, but also talk about the 640,000 people that we are seeking to give Bibles to just right now through the end of 2021.
Bible-based materials into 30 plus nations and in 20 plus different languages. As a result of 7 couples, they were in their 20s, no children yet, young marrieds, and they make the decision to pursue souls for Jesus, to travel to a foreign land where they've never been, in a foreign language that they didn't know, only to find out that nobody behind the Iron Curtain, as it was called at the time, had Bibles in their language.
The power to change the world is right here.
So Gwen Hensley, who really started EEM, came back and said, we have to change what we're doing. We have to provide God's word in people's languages. And people joined forces. There was amazing partnership. People paying to get the printing press up and going. It was amazing. And we stand on their shoulders. So here we are. It's our diamond anniversary. When you think about a diamond, first off, who creates a diamond? Not man, God does. And what creates a diamond? Time, pressure, stress, a lot of challenges. And that's what EEM has seen. Who would have thought that 60 years later, what started as a smuggling operation where they were thrilled to get 100 Bibles across a border, we're now driving tractor truckloads. We're printing in those very countries that forbid the Bible from being distributed. We're actually putting their people to work, and they're printing the Bible. We're putting Bibles in public schools in the nation of Ukraine.
We've donated Bibles to more than 10,000 schools.
And they're teaching the Bible as curriculum. It's happening in Hungary. It's now happening in Croatia, Romania, Bulgaria. It's spreading like wildfire. And last year, distributed 1.33 million Bibles in 1 year. Do you feel what God is doing? There are risks for people there. They're risking careers to get Bibles into public schools, risking providing a Bible to a neighbor in a Muslim country, realizing that they're a Muslim family. In Matthew 28, Jesus' call to us is to make disciples. Question for us is, are we doing it today? See, we believe that providing someone God's word is the first step in making disciples. Frequently people will ask me about EEM, and I'll tell them, we're in the parable of the sower business. We just need help buying seed. So the deal is, we're limited by funds. There are more requests right now than we have funds to provide. So that's where you come in. Maybe you're already a financial ministry partner with EEM, or maybe you're just considering that right now. I'm asking you to join us. Like our tagline says, the Bible, we want everyone to get it, but we need you. You are a part of this diamond anniversary story that is being played out right now. As we kick off this year's 2021 Million Dollar Sunday campaign.
So I'm not here tonight to pass a hat and to ask you to give more. Your church has given already. Some of you even give individually on a monthly basis. Others of you are saying, what's the name of this ministry again? EEM. But I hope that all of you will hear from me, thank you for what you're already doing. Thank you for the way that you're partnering with us to be able to let us say yes to more of what is now averaging more than 1 million people asking us and our ability to give Bibles to that many people. There's lots of different ways that you can be a part of this. Obviously, you're giving as a church, but what about prayer? What about other people that you know that we don't, that you might be able to share this opportunity with? There's all sorts of groups across this nation. We don't want to be a well-kept, hidden secret somehow. Perhaps you'd be willing to share with a leader at a church that you know. Maybe you have some family member out of state that doesn't know about this opportunity. Whatever the case, you could go to our website, EEM.org. Has this video, many other good pieces of information. There's some brochures back here on the back table. But let me join us together in prayer as we finish here, and then I think Ryan has one more announcement. Would you bow with me? Oh God, our Father, we thank you for your Son. We thank you for your Holy Spirit. We thank you that you continue to be patient with us, even in our sins, as your created people trying to sometimes go our own way. We thank you for calling us back to you. We thank you for all of us in this room that have given our lives to you. We pray that you would help us to not put limits on what you might call us to, that as we think about the sacrifice your Son made, help us to set no ceiling on what you may call us to. And we just pray again tonight that you would renew the passion in our hearts to give you 100% of who we are. May your word, as Isaiah the prophet said in chapter 55, may it go out and do what it was intended to do and not come back void. We thank you that your word has found a place in our hearts. Help us, Lord, as we have the opportunity to share the good news with the people that you have given us the blessing and the responsibility of knowing, close by, far away, around the world perhaps. But we thank you for giving us the opportunity. Help us to rise to the occasion like your Son did and to give you our entire being. We thank you again for Jesus, and we pray this all in his name. Amen.
All right, that wraps up class. Thanks so much, Lanny. Those of us with teens, go ahead and wander back toward the fellowship hall. The missions committee has provided the dinner there tonight. Lanny's got plenty of time, though. We'll save food for him. So everybody else, take a few minutes and visit with him some more. But teens and parents and brothers and sisters, we got plenty of food. So we are all done. Thanks a lot.